So welcome back. So my plan for today is to give you a very, very, very brief glimpse of how to look at hydrodynamic equations and how to derive them. And in particular, again, very give you a bird's eye view of how to get to the active hydrodynamic equations, which are the ones which are relevant to pattern formation biology. This will not be a very clean and thorough and pedagogical derivation. I'll just motivate and sketch the main points. I'll refer you to papers and books where you can follow these things in more detail. My point is that by the end of the first half, I should be able to at least get to a level where I can discuss some simple models for pattern formation in the active hydrodynamic context. And then we will be able to use the tools of linear stability analysis, the classifying spectra and all that we have developed over the past 2 days, and say something about the kind of patterns that emerge in these systems. Tomorrow, I'll complicate life a little bit more by looking at many of the things that I will forget today, and particularly orientation order, and again, illustrate some of these ideas by showing you some examples from living systems. And then I'll conclude with some open problems that are really hard. Okay, so like I said in the first lecture, the idea of trying to think about a hydrodynamic description for materials is to really look at the hydrodynamic description as an extension of thermodynamics, classical equilibrium thermodynamics, to the case where you have these thermodynamic variables now being functions of space and time. And so therefore, what you have is a system which is globally out of equilibrium by definition. But then you assume that the variation in these fields is so slow in space and time that locally or mesoscopic regions, the fields being very, very slowly varying, they attain a kind of local thermodynamic equilibrium. So locally, Pt, mu satisfy some local thermodynamic equilibrium relations, but globally they are not. I mean, so there isn't a uniform pressure throughout, there isn't a uniform temperature or chemical potential gradient and so on. And so therefore you would like to find out if there are fields, driving fields like this, surely they're going to give rise to fluxes, right? So pressure gradients generate mass currents, temperature gradients will generate energy currents, classical things that you learn in StatMech 101. Now, if you leave the system to itself, that is, you look at some spontaneous fluctuations, or maybe you give it a impulse perturbation at some point of time and you just don't do anything else, eventually the system will go back to its thermodynamic equilibrium state. You would like to maintain the system out of equilibrium by pumping in mass or momentum or energy or chemical reactions and so on. So therefore, you try to maintain the system out of equilibrium. And in such systems, there is a possibility that you'll actually have very nice looking patterns. But first, the first job is to actually derive what are the hydrodynamic equations describing the hydrodynamic variables when the system is perturbed away from equilibrium. So first is the idea that you want to write down a hydrodynamic description, even for a system which is at equilibrium, but slightly perturbed. And then maybe extend that by looking at non-equilibrium states. Okay. So the general theory of how to write down, this is the way one does it, that you take a many-body system, and once it's disturbed, you look at some modes which decay much more slowly compared to many other fast degrees of freedom. The fast degrees of freedom are the typical noisy terms that you put in, the stochastic degrees of freedom. And so there'll be the slow degrees of freedom, slow in the sense that I'll define in a moment. And you write down the dynamics for the densities of such variables, the densities of long-lived variables. And these are the hydrodynamic degrees of freedom. So I'll show you how to get those things. Again, I'll sketch those ideas. And typical slow modes, which are useful in our descriptions, are the conservation laws that come from conservation laws like mass, momentum, energy, typically mass and momentum, and also order parameters of continuously broken symmetries, particularly near phase transitions. Okay, so the idea really starts from thinking about the following picture. So I'm going to use the board as well. If it's not very visible, you can let me know. ITT, maybe you can focus on the board now and forget the presentation. I'll come back to the presentation in a few minutes. I don't even know if they heard me.
We can see the board.
People online can see the board?
Yeah, we can see. I can see.
So the idea is very simple, that if I have some isolated system, you all know the Einstein fluctuation formula, right? So if I have the total entropy of the system, and let's say I have some set of thermodynamic variables, AI. So the entropy is a function of all these thermodynamic variables, and they'll take some equilibrium values. You look at the deviations from the equilibrium values. And so therefore you can write the entropy of the system, the total entropy of the system, as a function of these values. I'll do it for one variable, but easily can extend it for many variables. And once you have the entropy, you also know that the probability of observing a particular fluctuation away from the equilibrium value is given by the Einstein fluctuation. So this is, let's say, P. And some constant C. C upstairs, downstairs. So this is the probability that you'll see a fluctuation of magnitude X, is A minus A bar, away from the equilibrium value. So remember, the equilibrium is when X is zero, and equilibrium is when S total is maximized. Okay. So if you're close to equilibrium, then surely you can do a small Taylor expansion, and so therefore write the entropy as basically something which is the equilibrium value minus some fluctuation. Okay, so some Taylor expansion. First term, first derivative vanishes because it's an optimum setting there. Okay, so if that's the case, you can ask, well, how does the entropy change? I mean, now the similar thing can be generalized to a multivariable case. And so let's say you have S total of X minus S naught, some constant like term times 1 to n, some Gij matrix, Xi. Okay, so far so good. Okay, so any perturbation, so if the variables Xi go away from zero, so this should be J, not K. The variables Xi go away from zero, then they will obviously give rise to entropy generation, and the entropy will not be a maximum, they'll only reduce the entropy. Surely the system will tend to generate fluxes. Those are the hydrodynamic fluxes that we are talking about. Basically, these fluxes. And the fluxes will be generated by the thermodynamic forces. So you define your Fi, some generalized thermodynamic force, as basically the derivative of the entropy with respect to variable that you're looking at. So this is basically Gij Xk Xj, the minus sign. Now you look at the expression for Fi and look at the expression for the total change in the entropy. So therefore, your entropy change itself from the equilibrium value, you see, you should be able to write this as some Okay, so that is sort of the general idea that there are forces and variables that come up there. So the rate of entropy production which is not difficult to do, just do some derivative of the boxed equation appropriately, you should be able to show that this is nothing but okay. So the picture that one is trying to say is that if you take the system, perturb it away from equilibrium, the deviations xi and the associated fluxes of those variables will lead to forces, and the product of the forces and the fluxes is what contributes to the production of entropy. Okay, so this is the general idea of linear irreversible thermodynamics. Really look at the book by De Groot and Mazur. Remember, maybe 62. I can't remember exactly. A modern variant is in the book by Roberto Mauri. I don't remember, 2013 or 14. So this is non-equilibrium. There's nothing new here. This is old stuff. This is how we learn how to write down irreversible thermodynamics.
Do forces remain constant with time?
Forces can depend on the variables x, their spatial gradients, whatever.
So why we are excluding the dot in the forces, like d by dt of delta s, there is no f dot.
Repeat that.
If we are doing the derivative, it should be xi into f I dot one addition.
Yeah, work that out, please. So I have this, take the derivative of this. So there'll be a product rule. So this dot and into that, and then this into this dot. Now you recognize that this is itself related to that. So these are constant coefficients. So this dot will come in. So there's a half, do all that algebra. So there's a half here, that there'll be two terms and do all that, it'll come out.
Okay, sir.
Okay, so the general idea, therefore, is that if you can identify the variables that you are interested in, and you look at the fluxes in those variables, whatever the forces that are generated by thermodynamics, the product of the forces and the fluxes is what leads to entropy production. So therefore, this is a tendency for the system to start going towards equilibrium. Now, one doesn't know how to model these things in general. So that's why Unsagar came up with this idea that you can think of the Unsagar relations. That is, you think about expanding the generalized forces in terms of the fluxes, or the other way around. You say the fluxes are a linear function of the generalized forces. So classical examples like stress is directly proportional to the strain rate. These are all examples of Unsagar relations. Or the heat flux is proportional to the gradient in the temperature, with the coefficient being the thermal conductivity. These are examples. So you can show, I won't be going into these details, that the coefficients Lij, the Unsagar coefficients, these are the kinetic coefficients here. These coefficients are related to equilibrium correlations of the fluxes. We have x dot of 0 of I, x dot 0 of A, averaged, integrated over time. So these are equilibrium average. So if you just stare at this, some of you might recognize this. This is just green covariations, which you get from linear response theory. Okay. So the assumption here is that you do these linear expansion. I mean, that is the, so you assume that you're not very far away from equilibrium. So this linear expansion is reasonably okay. There's no reason why that should work, but most of the time it seems to work. By looking at how these coefficients change under time reversals, remember that there'll be loads of terms in these equations which will be time reversal invariant. They cannot contribute to entropy production. And these coefficients are typically written as the broken down into the dissipative part and the reversible parts. The dissipative parts are symmetric under the change of the indices, whereas the reversible parts are anti-symmetric under the. So these contribute to entropy production. These do not. Okay, so this is abstract. And the idea now is to connect this to the standard ideas of conservation laws and densities of conservation laws. And this picture will come about when you try to write down the equations of motion for the densities, like momentum density, angular momentum density, or chemical concentration fields. And there you have to put in some phenomenological relationships between the various fluxes and the forces. So my idea was to show you that the equations of active matter that I'll show you can be derived from this formalism. The algebra is messy, takes several tens of pages, but it can be done. There's a very clean, systematic way of going from starting from something like entropy all the way to the equations that I show. And also the idea to show you that I will not be doing that. I will just show this equation for something which is generic enough, and I will write down the equations for conserved quantities. I'll just tell you that if you follow this, you'll get a bunch of equations for the variables of interest. And I'll refer you to review papers where these things are done in great detail. I mean, there are many, maybe one of the most recent ones. What is this? Reports on Progress in Physics or Progress? Okay, Reports on Progress. As done for active hydrodynamics. There are many, many examples. So, I mean, I'm not going to be extensive or anything.
So, can you just explain the reversible and the irreversible?
So, there'll be terms which come from some simple potential energies. For example, think of your favorite harmonic oscillator. That's something which is time reversal forces. There'll be forces which come from irreversible part, friction. It's really the frictional parts that contribute to entropy production. The reversible parts do not contribute to entropy production. And the reversible parts will be time reversal symmetric. And so therefore the Onsager coefficients connecting them to entropy production will have anti-symmetry. How do we say what? Oh, you'll have to work out the time reversal symmetry properties. Where is F? The forces, yes. They are what?
Time-dependent.
They are time-dependent. They are time-dependent. There could be dependent on X's.
Then should the right side, having F should be under the because these are like the linear response. Are these similar?
Hold on. Which one are you talking about? Yes. Yeah. You can put in time dependence. Xi of t's. If you want, you can put some integral of that, some time delay. My idea was just to show that the F's are related to the derivatives of the entropy with respect to X's. Those are the forces. Product of the forces and the fluxes gives rise to entropy production. And that much you can say in quite generality. Beyond that, I can't do anything. I have to say I'm close to equilibrium or something like that. Think of a linear response like picture. And so therefore you'll say the fluxes are linearly related to the forces. You can put in some kernels, momentum, all this is fine. And that is all you one can show. And like in linear response, you know that these coefficients will be related to the equilibrium correlations of the currents, flux. That much you can show quite generally. Now, what are these kinds of things? We'll go through this in a minute. Okay.
So the last equation.
Okay, one thing. The more questions you ask, the more time I'll spend here, the less time I'll get for patterns. Fine. Go ahead.
Yeah, so one small question. Like in the last equation.
Maybe use the mic. Nobody can hear you. Yeah.
So in the last equation, that is time reversible means Lijr equal to minus Ljir.
Oh, sorry. Thank you. You're right. Thank you. Yeah, the first one I wrote it correctly. Thanks. Okay, now this is one part of the story. The other part of the story is that you really want to think about equations for the conserved fields, right? Like the density field, the momentum field, and so on and so forth. So again, there will be a sketchy description here. Conservation laws, writing down conservation laws, and at some point of time, you'll see that there'll be certain terms which you can't do anything. So which really come from the fact that you're looking at coarse-grained descriptions. And therefore, thermodynamics must enter. And so the way you bring in the thermodynamic aspect is to write down equations for the production of entropy and then say, hey, the entropy production rate must be connected to forces and fluxes. So identify the forces and fluxes and then use generalized Onsager relationships to write down the equations of motion for the variables that you're interested in. That's how one can actually derive the equations of motion for mass densities, momentum densities, angular momentum densities, order parameter densities, whatever variables you want. And in general, as you can see now, the more variables you include, the more coupling coefficients they will appear. So it's a matter of the experiment and the problem that you are looking at. There was a question that got flashed and I missed it. Okay, that's on me. So if you write down the equations for conservation laws, densities of conserved quantities, right? These will typically take the form of continuity equations. So I'm sure you've all seen this. I'll just go through quickly. So there's mass conservation, so which is basically dt rho d alpha rho v alpha equal to zero. So this is the hydrodynamic velocity field. Einstein summation convention assumes, so repeated indices are summed out. You also write down conservation laws for the energy. So you have an energy density E. So you'll write down something for the energy density flux. The flux of the energy itself will be will have two parts. So one, there'll be the usual advective flux. That is true for every field that comes up here. And there'll be a part which is the internal fluxes. And this is where the thermodynamics will start appearing. Alpha downstairs, E upstairs. Momentum conservation, basically a restatement of second law, but for fields, you'll define the momentum density G alpha as rho times V alpha. And so dt G alpha, you will again write this as the derivative of a second rank tensor. So this second rank tensor, sigma, is basically the momentum flux tensor, which you typically write it as a stress tensor and a product of the velocity and the momentum density. So one is the convective part, which is easy to see. And then there is a part which will have some material dependencies. Final quantity that you write down, so I don't forget this, is angular momentum. So I will not go through this in any detail, for a simple fluid, for a fluid which has isotropic particles, you can show that angular momentum conservation is already there in some symmetry properties of the stress tensor. I will not go through that, but for a fluid which has some non-trivial internal structure, you can show that the angular momentum density will have an appropriate angular momentum flux tensor. And you can break up this total angular momentum into the spin part and the orbital angular momentum part. The spin part is because if you have some fields where, let's say you have a fluid made up of rods, not really point particles. So the rods themselves can have orientational degrees of freedom, which means they have angular momentum, internal angular momentum. So it's like a spin variable. Nothing to do with the quantum mechanical spin. This is classical stuff. So you have to write down those equations. And at the end of the day, you can just show that the for simple fluids, simple isotropic fluids. I just want to mention this because we will look at some cases where the system is not isotropic. Isotropic fluids, angular momentum conservation really boils down to the following, that the symmetric, the stress tensor must be symmetric.
Excuse me. What's the second term in the stress tensor?
What is the second term in the stress tensor? I've only written one stress tensor. Okay. So this is the stress tensor. I mean, different people call it by different names. So if you refer one book, it'll be called something else. So this is the momentum flux tensor. This I'll call the stress tensor. And there is a part which comes from the convection of the momentum. Is that fine?
Yeah.
Okay. Now, so there are mechanical fields like mass, momentum, energy, angular momentum. But for a complex system like what we are looking at, there are also the chemical concentration fields. So for example, you could have a fluid which has many chemical species amongst itself. So you can define, therefore, the number densities of the chemical fields Ni and write down conservation laws for the Ni as well, or mass balance equations. So there'll be the similar things. There'll be a flux coming up. And there'll be the source and sink terms. So this will be represented by the chemical reaction. So again, the fluxes will have a part which is made up of the usual advective thing and something that comes from internal reactions. Yeah.
Is different from mass, is it?
So I was going to write that in a minute. So this is the number density of the particles. So obviously, each of the species can undergo some sort of chemical reactions. So therefore, you will need to write down the following. Chemical reactions, that is, each of the species can get sort of interconverted into each other. You can write it as the following. So let's say you denote the symbol AI to represent the chemical species, and you write down some multi-index object. And you can write this down as basically zero. So this is an abstract rotation. You catch hold of all the chemical reactions, put everything to the left-hand side. So there are stoichiometric coefficients for each of the variables, A plus B, A plus B plus 3C equal to zero. And you collect them all together, and that gives you the chemical reactions. The rates at which these chemical species get generated are related to the stoichiometric coefficients, AI, for each stoichiometric reaction. Surely, the total mass, like Sanjib was asking, is related to the mass of the individual species times the number density and summed over all the species. One, two, I don't remember what I was saying. Yeah. This should be M. N species, M reactions. So therefore, mass conservation, the total material conservation, will imply that there must be some constraints between these. So species can get converted into each other. They have to preserve the total amount of material. So therefore, the Ni and the Ji are not independent. There'll be some relationship. I mean, if you have N plus one species and you have M chemical reactions amongst them, so then there are N minus one conservation laws, right? I mean, there are some constraints that have to be worked out. Okay, so where is all this leading to? It's becoming, now, in addition to this, there can be orientational degrees of freedom, which I'm not even going to discuss, but should think about. I'll just flash the equations, but I will not discuss. So for example, you could have things which are objects which are polar, arrow-like objects, or you could have things which are nematic-like objects. So you'll have to write down similar equations of motion for the orientational degrees of freedom. At the end of the day, what do you want to do? I want to connect to thermodynamics. So that means what I do is to consider a system which is at local thermodynamic equilibrium. So just like we said, it's gone now, the pressure, temperature, chemical fields are functions of position and time. Well, surely the entropy will also be a function of position and time. So you can define entropy density. So there's a total entropy and you define that as the entropy density into volume. And similarly, you can define the entropy, the free energy density. You write down a conservation law for the entropy as well. I mean, it's an evolution equation, the balance equation. So if the entropy changes at a particular volume, well, it's only because entropy was either produced or lost there, or some amount went to the neighboring regions. Now, this one, if there is a local entropy production rate, theta, will have sources and sinks. Okay, so this is where the connection to the previous set of equations comes in. So what you do is to look at these equations. Surely there are things for which I don't know what to do. There are things like the stress tensor. I have to write down some closed equations. I have to make some approximations. This is basically the momentum flux. This is the flux, right? So XI dot that I wrote down earlier. So there's a momentum flux, which is second rank tensor. And so there'll be the forces, and I have to identify the forces and write down a linear relationship between the fluxes and the forces. That's my own Onsager relation. Once you write down those things and you identify things which are symmetric under time reversal, anti-symmetric under time reversal change, or don't, you identify the symmetries of the Onsager relationships, and then you identify the entropy production rate. Aha, so therefore, that's where combinations like fluxes and forces will appear, and they will come into this part. So what you have to do, a major job, is really to identify what are the forces and the fluxes. That itself is a headaching job. So you go through this algebra, there are mechanical things, you appeal to the first law of thermodynamics, you find out the E is U minus TdS, F is equal to U minus TdS kind of a relationship. You find out the change in the energy because you have an energy equation, and you change in the, you usually assume some constant temperature system. And then you can figure out what are the conjugate forces and fluxes. That's the whole job. And so once you've identified that, you identified what are the things that give rise to the production of entropy. And from there you use Onsager to write down linear relationships. I will definitely not be able to do all that here. I'll just sketch what happens for a simple isotropic fluid. No chemical reactions, no orientational degrees of freedom. So for a simple isotropic fluid, this procedure will, at the end of the day, give you that the stress tensor will be related to the strain rate tensor, grad alpha, let's say in grad alpha V beta. Okay, let's not even write that. We'll show that the entropy production rate will be proportional to the product of the stress tensor and the strain rate tensor. Aha, so therefore this is really like X dot into F, or XI dot into FI. Okay, once you do that, then you appeal to Onsager and then say, my stress tensor will be linearly related to the forces. So therefore the coefficients are the appropriate Onsager kinetic coefficients. So this too, you have to worry about the tensorial symmetries, and the most appropriate one turns out to be something like the following, that you have the symmetric traceless part of the stress tensor. And the trace of the stress tensor. These will have independent coefficients. So one you call the shear viscosity, and the other one you call the bulk viscosity. So one can, in general, not do all this circus and just say, like you do in simple derivations of Navier-Stokes, consider a fluid element. There are forces from the neighboring elements. There are change in moment of here, and you just declare, oh, Newton Baba said sigma is equal to eta grad V. All I'm saying is that you can relate all that to nice thermodynamic descriptions very, very cleanly. There's a self-consistent theory describing them. So you get only two coefficients. Remember, this is a second rank tensor related to another second rank tensor. So the general relationship is a fourth rank tensor. You should appeal to things like there is a spatial symmetry, there is isotropy. And so all these coefficients can be reduced, and you can show in three dimensions is basic. So if you take this kind of a stress tensor now and plug it in here and identify that this is what goes as the derivative of the momentum density, you will get the Navier-Stokes equations. It's basically a restatement of the second law. So as I said, extremely sketchy, no derivations. It'll take a full course to derive all these things. My idea was to show you that these equations are not magic. They don't come by somebody just picking up someday and writing it out. That's how some people discovered it. And it's their ingenuity. So one doesn't even go through all this procedure. One just says, hey, I want the equation of motion for, let's say, a polar order parameter. So I write down all possible terms permitted by symmetry. What symmetries? Maybe the symmetries of space-time. Like I want the system to be a translation invariant, not have any particular time parameter. Okay, fine. Maybe P to minus P symmetry. So you write down all those terms. And furthermore, if you relax the idea that the system should not have time reversal symmetry, which means it can be out of equilibrium, certain new terms come up. Those are the active terms. So people wrote down things like that. And then over the past decade or so, we've understood that, okay, so all that can also be derived within this classical format very nicely. So the isotropic part of the stress tensor, you're good. Thanks. So this should be the pressure. I might screw up the plus or minus. It doesn't matter. But
And should that be 1 by D or 2 by D?
It should be 2 by D. Thank you. Very good. So people are awake. So the book by Roberto Mauri that I mentioned, I recommend that as a modern reference, which has all these things worked out in lots of details. I can't remember the title. I think it's Non-Equilibrium Thermodynamics of Multiphase Flows. I think 2013, maybe 2014, I don't remember. Goes through all these things, and the initial thing that I looked at the entropy production in terms of the forces and the fluxes, the notation and all, I took it from that book. Okay, so that's generally the idea in which one derives these equations. So what are the kind of things for which you want to write down active hydrodynamic descriptions? We knew momentum conservation from a very long time, I mean, right? Navier-Stokes is 150 years old, and Navier-Stokes with chemical reactions was also something not new. The idea that historically, that there are orientational degrees of freedom, cells are elongated objects, or even for more macroscopic things like fish schools or bird flocks, there are orientational degrees of freedom. And somehow the fact that these things are not static, they move around, there's some non-zero currents there, led to the derivation of equations like say the Tonneau-Tout model for flocking, or the generalized version of that, including the ambient fluid momentum, which is worked out by Sriram Ramaswamy. All these things sort of gave us a picture for thinking about hydrodynamics for complex fluids. Simultaneously, people were working on looking at the hydrodynamics of structures within the cell and at the tissue level. It so turned out that these two things are identical at some level. And so therefore, one can start looking at the equations for such variables. So I'll go to the slide now, and I'll show you some of the equations there. Okay, so that's the picture that we had. So like what I summarized earlier, so you could have fields which are just simple scalar fields like density fields. You could obviously have flow fields for things which are moving around. But in addition, you could have orientational degrees of freedom, which could be polar or pneumatic. And in addition, the chemical reactions. So caveat here, so you can have all these complicated things, and if you satisfy the Onsager relations, time reversal symmetry, everything, well, the whole system is at equilibrium. The idea of non-equilibrium fluxes comes in because you say, you declare by hand, by looking at experimental systems, that there are certain terms which I will hold fixed, some chemical concentration or some chemical potential. So there is some pumping that I'm doing from the boundaries. And so therefore you break time reversal symmetry, so you break the equilibrium. And so therefore it becomes a non-equilibrium active system. Okay, so this is a table from the review paper by Yulisha that I mentioned. So there's a long table there which sort of lists all the forces and the fluxes. I just showed you only one of them, which is the simple fluids viscous stress tensor. So that is proportional to the forces and the fluxes of the velocity gradient tensor. You can go through a long list, where is the pointer, of systems which have orientational degrees of freedom. And so there will be the time derivative of the orientational fields, and there'll be a molecular field conjugate to that. Or you can look at pneumatic systems, chemical systems, and even things which are angular momentum, which is basically having some chirality in the system, odd elasticity, odd viscosity, for example. And you can write down the corresponding Onsager relations between them. Once you do that, you would like to go to, so you develop all this grand theory, but I want to look at some biological phenomena, and hopefully I will be able to do something today. So one of the interesting things for which this kind of a system was first developed was trying to understand these structures called the cytoskeleton inside the cells. So like I mentioned, cells undergo a variety of phenomena. They undergo division, movement, polarity, and so on and so forth. And people always wondered what is the mechanical basis for these things. And in the early, mid-90s, early 2000s, people began to recognize that there's this structure called the cytoskeleton. Historically, of course, it was known much earlier too. And somehow non-equilibrium processes inside the cytoskeleton are essentially responsible for many of the cellular processes that you do. And so there's an attempt to discuss and derive the appropriate equations for the cytoskeleton made up of these filaments. And one wrote down these equations for active polar gels or active pneumatic gels. This is a work from the groups in Dresden and Paris. And simultaneously, there were works going on in trying to understand fish schooling or bird flocking, works by Toner II, Shriram, and many other people from here. And at some point in the early 2000s, late 2000, early to whatever, around 2007, 8, 5, 6, 7, 8, I don't know exactly when, people recognize that these things are very similar to each other. And so therefore, there's a very nice unified description that comes up here. So this structure, which is beneath the surface of cells, is something that is responsible for a lot of cellular processes, in particular cell division. And so what I want to give you is a flavor of the physics of, I don't know where I put the pointer. So just beneath the plasma membrane of cells, there is this thin layer of actin filaments interspersed with myosin motors. And there are loads and loads of GUI proteins also sticking out through the membrane. We won't go into these details. Fundamental work from NCBS, Madan Rao Jitumeya's group, has shown how patterns in this thin layer, I'll discuss some models for these patterns, how patterns in that coupled to the dynamics of proteins sitting on the membrane, which functionally are related to, for example, how cells talk to each other. So it's a quite complex system, but the essential idea that makes the system be out of equilibrium is the fact that there are these motor proteins, tiny protein molecules, which have some part of their structure on one filament and another part on their structure on the other filaments. They undergo a conformational change driven by a chemical reaction, ATP, adenosine triphosphate, some fuel, which is a common currency for all living processes on Earth. ATP hydrolyzes to ADP, diphosphate, and inorganic phosphate. There's an energy released. This energy is used to change the conformation. The conformation generates force dipoles. So the picture that I drew here of having chemical reactions coupled to mechanical degrees of freedom, and so therefore driving chemical reactions can generate mechanical stresses. Once you have mechanical stresses, well, things can move around. If things can move around, you can get patterns. And somehow, we have no idea about how these things work, cells use these patterns to do whatever they do. We're very, very, very far away from understanding. So the essential feature is really a non-trivial coupling between the chemistry and the mechanics, and which can be understood within this formalism. So the non-equilibrium aspect says that the food that you eat, somehow some metabolic processes, loads of details there, is eventually converted to this excess of ATP. Excess of this chemical ATP. So you're always driving this way, the reaction. The other way also happens, but there is a net flux from ATP to, so that's where you break detail. So this flux that you maintain by eating food drives this mechanics, which drives all these cellular processes. You're very far from understanding any of the details to build tiny, simple models. Okay. One particular structure for which I'll work out some simple models is this structure called the actomyosin cortex, which I was mentioning just a few minutes ago, as a structure which is just beneath the plasma membrane, has this actin filaments, the ones in blue here are the ones in green here, sorry. And this structure is like half a micron thick structure, undergoes loads of turnover, which makes it a fluidy-like structure. And on timescales longer than this relaxation timescales, you can think of it basically like a fluid, viscous stress relaxation, elastic stress relaxation happens faster. You can write down an effective two-dimensional description. Okay, so that's the story. That's how people have written down these active hydrodynamic gels. So there are some review papers here. You can take a look at them. So to summarize, you write down equations for movement, densities, or number densities. You have force balance, you write down the Navier-Stokes inversion, you forget all inertial terms. For biological problems, those things become negligible. you write down the constitutive relation, which is the relationship between, let's say, the stress tensor and the strain rate tensor, those are the linear relations that I mentioned to you. And if you have orientation degrees of freedom, you write down the equations of motion for such fields as well. All these get coupled. In addition to the usual passive stresses that you would get for a systematic equilibrium, you have these active stresses, things that come from basically ATP to ADP hydrolysis. So again, appealing to symmetry, Onsager reciprocity, you can write down the generalized version of these things in the linear level. So you get these active stresses. So this sort of gives you a full coupled system. We understand some parts of the phases that the system of equations, the system of models can show, not all. So I'll summarize this and I'll write out this for a particular case of a polar fluid, and you'll see the complexity of the equations, and I'll simplify it to one particular model. So like I mentioned, force balance, this is basically Newton's second law, not worrying about inertia, wherein you write down next a constitutive relationship, which tells you how the stresses are related to the strain rates, epsilon is grad V. And if you have orientational fields, you have order parameter stresses, again, everything from equilibrium. The evolution of the order parameter you can derive like what we did earlier using the hydrodynamic approach. If there are chemical species, you write down equations for the number densities of the chemical species with the advection, the diffusion, and the chemical reaction terms. And now, in addition to the system is out of equilibrium, you have additional active stresses, which actually appear as something coming from orientational degrees of freedom, and also regulated by the chemical concentrations of these markers. Okay. If you have an order parameter which is polar, there are certain new terms which are permitted by breaking time reversal symmetry, and this is the full description. There was a question and I lost that. I could not see it quickly. Yeah, so what I'm trying to write down is an equation for a viscoelastic fluid. So in principle, these polymeric meshworks also have elasticity at short time scale. So this is a model for a Maxwell-Jeffrey fluid, where at short time scales, it's a elastic solid, long time scales, it's a fluid, and the crossover time scale is basically the Maxwell relaxation time, tau L. Okay, too many things. Surely it's quite complicated. No surprise. One would like to understand things in some simplified descriptions and see if there is some simple models that will get the essence of the patterns that are there. And that's the model that I want to describe. So we'll make an assumption that, remember, this is writing for an effective two-dimensional system. And so I'm going to assume that in that two-dimensional plane, there is isotropy. And I will also assume that the viscoelasticity can be neglected. So therefore, all these terms go away. So I forget completely the orientational degrees of freedom, the elastic degrees of freedom. And so what I'm left with is a simple fluid, which has a force balance and a stress, which depends only on the velocity gradients. This coupled with some simple chemical reactions, I'll try to set up a model which shows some non-trivial patterns. So the formal way you get the two-dimensional theory is by doing a integration over the height. I'll just sketch that. I won't go through the full details. So you have the full stress tensor in 3D. Remember, you have the cell. There is this thin layer of the cell of some thickness H. And so you integrate this over the thickness and you get an effective two-dimensional stress tensor. And that's the stress tensor that I was showing you about. You also assume that this material undergoes continuous turnover. So the material density will be neglected, the total density. And so what you'll be left with is the concentration fields of chemicals, number densities, and the velocity fields. And that's the model that we are trying to describe. So you can show again that the two-dimensional pressure will can be eliminated because there will basically turn out to be some relationship between the density and the pressure. And that effectively changes the bulk viscosity, the 2D bulk viscosity of the system. So I won't go into that part of the story. Okay, can we have the presentation back again? Yeah, sure. Okay, so that's the constitutive relation there. So I have the stress tensor, which has the usual hydrodynamic parts, the shear viscosity and the bulk viscosity, and the active stress tensor, which can be driven by the chemical concentration fields of some. So I take the stress tensor, I put it into the force balance equation, I get an equation of motion for the fluid. And remember, I also am thinking of a thin film, so I can put in an external force in a frictional approximation. Now the two equations in the yellow have a very nice rich structure of patterns. And that's what I want to illustrate. Okay, is this a good picture? I mean, I did so many, I wrote such a complicated structure and then I list off a lot of things and is this even useful? Turns out it is. This picture of having stress gradients and in particular active stress gradients being the sources for the flow has been tested in experiments in real cells. This is an experiment from the C. elegans embryo, one of the model creatures that is used in developmental biology. And what you can do is to look at the thin film. There's supposed to be an imaging plane, which is missing here. So you're basically looking at the thin film there. And so that appears as a 2D structure. You can measure its velocity field, simple image analysis techniques. And you can try to see if the prediction from the theory matches what you can measure. And it turns out to be quite good. I mean, remember, this is a living worm, and inside the embryo of a living worm, you can actually measure velocity fields predicted from linear irreversible thermodynamics, and you can measure concentration fields of chemicals that you think are causing the flows, and the match is rather good. So this seems to be an effectively good picture.
So it's a two-dimensional velocity field, right? Yes. It doesn't like go into the third dimension.
Has all kinds of complications.
But in the model, you're not, that's not, it's completely two-dimensional and there's no third.
Okay. No, in the model, I'll show you 2D things as well. So in this experiment, what was done is, again, there's some other physics there. There's a large scale flow from the right to the left. So what was done is to take this 2D plane, get a 2D velocity field, average it along the y direction, look at only the x component of the flow. So what you're plotting is the x component of the flow along the position. So this is the driving field, concentration of some motor molecule. And if you assume some motor molecule is directly proportional to the stress tensor, you have a source for the flow field, which you can fit and get these two parameters.
Okay. This follows from the other model that you wrote.
Yep. Exactly that. So I'm just looking at variations in 1D. It's exactly the same model. If I have a one-dimensional model, there's no shear viscosity, there's only the bulk viscosity, and there's only one derivative.
Okay.
And I'm using a frictional approximation for F external, and there's only one species.
Okay. That describes this experiment, kind of. And sort of, can you motivate this, stress coming from the active thing?
So that's basically the same thing as what I had earlier. So this is the full complicated story where you have an active stress, which gets generated by certain active terms, basically chemical reactions. This is the mechanochemical coupling that I was talking about. There can be an isotropic part, there can be an anisotropic part from the orientation fields. The strength of these active terms is regulated by the concentration fields, the number density fields of the motor proteins. So if there are motor proteins, they do this tugging, force dipoles, they generate stresses. If there are no motor proteins, there are no stresses, there are no active stresses. So typically in chemistry, you have this thing that, the rates will saturate. This is like a Michaelis-Menten kinetics that you can think about. So it goes up and then saturates over a certain period of time. The essence of the argument doesn't depend on this functional form. For linear stability, we'll neglect all that. We'll just take the linear thing and it still works. Okay. And that's basically the picture that I assumed here. So the point of this argument was to show that even though you wrote down a complicated hydrodynamic description, if you look at the appropriate time scales and length scales where you can neglect many of the aspects of the orientation degrees of freedom and anisotropy, then you can get an effective equation which you can actually test in the experiment, test in the real living world, and it seems to work.
Vijay.
Yeah.
So that del- derivative term is the active term in that equation.
Derivative term is the active term. And the active term, the C is the contractility. It's the what's called the active stress. And so the active stress is directly proportional to the myosin concentration. Myosin is the motor that generates the stresses. Or you can put in something with some saturating, I mean, within the error bars, you can't even distinguish the two things.
M also has a dynamics, right?
The M has, exactly. So this theory just said, hey, I'll measure M, I'll measure C. These two are related by this, by some active hydrodynamics. Is that true first? Yes, it is in living systems. Now, exactly what you asked, is there a dynamics for M? And so this is a super simple model which predicts very nice patterns. And this is what I want to work out today. So this is a model which says there's one molecule M, which has a simple movement by advection and diffusion. And this molecule M is special because it's the molecule that generates the active stresses. So I take this molecule and put it in the active stress. The gradients of the active stress generates the flow. This we just verified experimentally. So now this is a coupled system. And you can just start from here. One thing that I debated is maybe I just start this as a definition of a model. But then you'll ask me, what is the physics of that? And so I have to go through all that. So my job now is to take this system of equations and do linear stability analysis and show you that this has a non-trivial pattern-forming structure. Okay, so I'll flash the slides and the videos, and then I'll go to the board and work out this model. So the essential argument comes from recognizing that there is a Peclet number, which is basically a measure of how activity and diffusion scale against each other. So if the activity beats diffusion, turns out the homogeneous state is unstable. And you actually will derive this. We will get a growth rate versus the wave vector, which is of the type 2S instability that we discussed here. And if you do a numerical simulation, indeed you get a big blob coming up. Remember, like we discussed yesterday, the first mode that undergoes an instability is the longest wave number allowed, or the shortest wave number allowed, or the longest wavelength that is allowed. And so therefore, you'll only get one big spot in the system. You can modify that slightly by putting in a linear chemistry here. And this time, the growth rate curve becomes like the type 1 instability, which means the growth rate at zero wave number is some negative number. And you get an instability at a finite wave, the finite non-zero wave vector. And this time, you'll get beautiful hexagonal patterns. Okay. So in the next 20, 25 minutes, I want to work out this model. Oh no, random initial conditions. Yeah. I mean, if you put, let's say, no flux boundaries or something, that'll act as an attractor. But in periodic boundaries, it's random. This is in two dimensions. Yeah, I mean, it can easily be generalized. Same 2D model that I used earlier. So far, so good. I'll go to the board and work out the linear stability for this.
So minus K and minus
M. Yeah. So I said the material always undergoes a turnover, so which means this is the surface of the cell. So this molecule M can be bound to the surface or can fall off into the bulk of the cell and can rebind again. So there is a continuous exchange between the surface and the bulk. That's at the lowest order, I can represent that by some exponential relaxation. K has to be positive, otherwise there's an exponential blow. Just stare at this, DTM is plus KM, you're in trouble. So far, so good? Okay.
I have a question. So in this above plot where there is type 2 instability,
yes.
For a wave vector where the growth rate is maximum, that corresponds to the length scale at which we see a dominant defect.
No, okay. I mean, like we discussed yesterday. So below the critical parameter value, all modes are stable. At the critical parameter value, you will hit that the smallest non-zero Q allowed in the system will have a positive growth rate, or at least a zero growth rate at the critical value. Remember, the growth rate at K k equal to, q equal to 0 must be strictly 0. Remember, this is for the case when this term is not there. M is a total conserved quantity. Okay. So therefore, the growth rate at q equal to 0 must be strictly 0. So therefore, the first time some growth rate becomes positive is for the smallest non-zero q, which in a finite size system is 2 pi by L. Let's say with periodic boundary condition.
So as
further from the instability, further away from the instability, it looks like there are a bunch of modes which are unstable. So you can ask, hey, how is it that I'm not getting a finite wavelength pattern? So this is something which I do not have a clear-cut answer to. You can do numerical simulations, and many a times it turns out that there are multiple spots that come up. Eventually, all the spots merge. I don't have an intuitive answer why they do that.
So when all the spots merge, the pattern, the blob, big blob that they form, its length scale is the wave number that at which we get the maximum growth rate when it is unstable.
So I don't know what you mean by its length scale. I mean, there's one blob and this is a heat map. So, I mean, you shouldn't think of this as zero or non-zero. It's some smooth variation.
Like if I want to find the size of this blob, like the diameter.
So what one can show is if you make the Peclet number larger and larger, this becomes a more and more concentrated drop. So which means it's a high concentration in a very small region. The peak becomes very, very sharp.
Okay.
But you seem to get only one spot. I can start with the initial condition with multiple spots. It does some complicated dynamics. Eventually, it seems to go into one spot.
Yeah, so I was just wondering, when we get this one blob in the end, when all of them merge, if there is a way we can find like what is the length of, what is the typical diameter we will get, if is there a way to
predict? Yeah, I mean, you can work out that. I mean, it will typically be set by the Peclet to diffusion in some sense. I mean, if the Peclet becomes larger, it will be inverse of this in some sense. So the higher the Peclet number, the smaller the size of the drop. It will become very, very sharp. That's all you can say.
Okay.
This one is just the evolution of these equations, right?
Exactly. Yeah. That's all.
So these equations are deterministic. So only variation is your initial condition, I guess, right? So I guess the where the blob appears should just depend on the initial condition, right? Yeah. So whatever the initial that suggests where the blob appears, basically.
Exactly. I mean, if I put some no-flux boundary, then you've broken the time transfer, space transfer.
Yeah, exactly.
That'll act as an attractor.
But if you put a periodic boundary condition,
completely
then
random.
It's just the initial condition, right?
Okay, so I'll switch to the board and work out this model in some detail in 1D and show you that there is a non-trivial pattern forming instability happen. So it turns out that this model can be mapped to some effective Hamiltonian picture. This is known in reaction diffusion systems as well in 1D. And you can show that there is some pattern forming states possible. So this is my model. So I'll do it in 1D, easy to extend it in more than 1D. So the field, the variables are some C, which is basically the number density of myers in motors. And the velocity field or the hydrodynamic velocity field of the cortex. The total amount of C, I will start with this description. The total amount of C integrated over the domain L is a constant. So what I'm thinking about is a one-dimensional domain. And I'll assume periodic or no flux boundaries. And the results don't change qualitatively. So integrated over this domain, the total amount of C remains a constant. So which means C must satisfy a continuity equation. Now, C is a molecule which gets advected by the hydrodynamic flows. There is an advective flux, and it can also diffuse around the cortex. So these two equations tell you the dynamics for the evolution of C. Now, I don't know what is V, and usual picture is maybe you give some constant V, but then there's no non-trivial dynamics happening there. The activity comes in the following way, that you say the molecule C regulates the active stresses with some strength. Well, how does that affect V? You say, I write down force balance, that is the gradients of these stresses, the total stress must balance whatever external forces that are there in the system. And remember, the picture that I have is that this is really part of the cellular surface, small region of the cellular surface. And so therefore, there is the cytoplasm of the cell, the inside fluid of the cell, and there is also the membrane of the cell at the top. So surely this layer is going to interact with the top and bottom environments. I don't know how to describe them. In the simplest coarse-grained approximation, I'll think of the external forces as given by a frictional term. So I have dx sigma total is gamma v as my force balance equation. So what is the total stress? Well, the total stress has two parts. One, there is a passive stress, and there is an active stress. Passive stress is easy. This is a simple fluid-like description. So I'm looking at the time scales, long time scales, long compared to the stress relaxation time scales. And so therefore, I'm working in the fluid-like, forgetting the elasticity. So in that limit, the passive stress is basically Newtonian viscous stress. There's only one viscosity in 1D. So there's a passive stress, there's an active stress, there's a force balance, that is the equation for V, and that couples to the equation for C. So if you put that all together, you get the following set of equations. So dTc will be minus dx Vc plus d grad squared C, eta grad square V minus gamma V will be minus zeta delta mu dx of f of c. Remember, c is a function of x. That's my complete model. So far, so good. So there is the homogeneous state. Where I have C equal to C naught everywhere. By the way, I forgot, so I should put an L here. C equal to C naught everywhere and V equal to zero everywhere. So that's one homogeneous state, right? No patterns. So the concentration is uniform everywhere and there's no velocity. And so I want to ask, is this state stable? Stable to what? Stable to perturbations which are non-uniform. Uniform perturbations won't do anything because the total amount of C is conserved, so therefore it doesn't do any change. So I want to put in non-uniform perturbations and then ask for the stability of the state. I want to put in a perturbation like e to the iqx with q not equal to zero and ask if this homogeneous state is stable against such perturbations. So I'll assume a periodic boundary condition. You can show that the results don't change even if you put no flux boundaries. In fact, the total current turns out to be zero for both PBC and no flux conditions. Let me not go through that. I was planning to go through that, but I'm already late. If you notice the velocity equation, it's a linear differential equation for V. In fact, it's a linear ODE for V. There's only one variable. And this is the driving term. So it's not difficult to solve this. You can do in Fourier, or you can write down Green's functions, blah, blah, blah. So therefore, you can, in a Fourier representation, this will become minus eta Q squared minus gamma acting on VQ will be minus zeta delta, or IQ times zeta delta mu times F of C Fourier transform. Agree? Which means I can solve for the velocity field. So this will be IQ zeta delta mu F of C. No, I think I did a mistake. So there should be a derivative here too. Thanks. Let's do it in one place. Let's do one by one. Let's do a linear stability analysis first, and then let's come back to that. So I'm going to do a perturbation. So that is, I'll put C as C naught plus delta C. And V is whatever, 0 plus delta V. And I would like to find out the equations for these things at the linear level. So first of all, you notice that this can be written in the following way. So this is zeta delta mu times the df dc derivative times dxc. So the function f, I don't know, but I do know the following, that the molecule C increases the stress. And so I want this to be something which will increase with C and perhaps saturate with C. So f of C versus C typically has this behavior. So one simple model that is used is some C by C plus C star. Or star for fixed points, let's say, and CS. Okay, so the linearized equations will therefore be for the velocity eta del square agree, which you can solve in Fourier space. I mean, give this some name. I'll retain that. So if you solve this in Fourier space, you'll get VQ as basically IQ by gamma plus eta Q square times zeta delta mu times DF by DC evaluated at C. So df by dc is just some number. I do a similar thing.
First equation.
Repeat that.
First equation, it should be del x of delta c, right?
Thanks. Del x of delta c. Thank you. So again, I also forgot one more thing. This will be delta C Q. Right? So VQ is driven by delta C Q, or okay, again, delta VQ with some kernel. So write down the similar thing for the concentration equation. So you get DT delta C. So the diffusion term is rather easy. So this will just be the advection term, work out, there'll be two parts to the story. So this is dx of V plus delta V, V naught is zero. So it's just delta V times C naught plus delta C. And so to linearized order, so this would be D square that minus C naught dx delta V. And another term, which will be a higher order term, which I can forget. So far, so good. So as usual, like we did in the Fourier velocity case, assume a Fourier basis, assume periodic boundary conditions. So e to the iqx is a good eigenbasis. So therefore, I can write dt delta cq as basically minus dq square delta cq minus C naught times IQ times delta VQ. So I already have delta VQ. I'm going to put that there. And so therefore I get DT delta CQ as basically equal to DQ square minus, actually plus Q squared by gamma plus eta q square times C naught times zeta delta mu times this function df by dc evaluated at that, the whole thing times delta cq. Is this visible or is it gone behind the board? There's no cut paste. So the point here is that the growth rate that we've been looking at, lambda q, is basically this factor. So it's d plus 1 by eta plus eta q square plus gamma times these factors. So whatever, there's some c naught into zeta delta mu into df by dc and c naught. Whole thing into q square. So far, so good. Yeah. Okay. So then you have a dispersion relation, a growth rate curve, which is definitely going to zero as q tends to zero. But if you crank up these coefficients, which basically turns out to be a Peclet number, it is possible that at q equal to zero, the growth rate is zero. At very large q, it's again zero. But at some intermediate q, it does turn out to be positive. So the condition for instability would be where this thing actually goes to zero. And you find out the smallest q where this can happen. Q equal to zero, it's always stable. So therefore the smallest q, smallest non-zero q this can happen is when q is 2 pi by L. And so the instability condition would therefore tell you that when lambda is zero, so that means D minus, help me with this, 1 by eta 2 pi by L the whole square plus gamma C naught zeta delta mu and this function df by dc. When this is positive, is when the instability, or the critical point is when this is equal to zero. Okay, let me write. So you can define a Peclet number, which is basically zeta delta mu divided by gamma times D. And a length scale L, which is square root of eta by gamma. And so therefore, what you will get is a criteria which is like I might be screwing up this, but help me. So this will be 2 pi by L, the whole square. So I take out a gamma, so therefore give me L square plus 1. So I've taken out a gamma, zeta delta mu by gamma d. So that is C naught times the Pecle times df by dc. Okay, so when this is positive, voila, you have an instability. So as you can notice, these are all just some numbers that are given, some total amount, some derivative of this function at the total amount value. So Pecle is basically the strength of the active stresses. So if you crank up the active stresses, the homogeneous state becomes unstable and you can start forming value. So this is probably the simplest example that I know of a mechanochemical pattern. Mechanochemical because the chemistry is the process that is responsible for generating mechanical stresses from chemical reactions. That feeds into an active stress. Active stress gradients drive flows. Flows advect concentration fields of molecules. And so the feedback between this movement and mechanical stress generation, if the activity is large enough, can lead to a battle. So this is the first case where that kappa is zero. So it's basically a type 2S instability. If you include kappa, like we did for the diffusion case, it's easy to see all that will happen is this will add up a minus kappa term. And so therefore at Q equal to zero, the growth rate will be some negative value minus kappa. And you get an instability at a finite non-zero Q. And that is what sets the spacing of those hexagonal patterns. I'm sure there'll be questions, so I won't go into the next part. So the next part was really trying to see that if I can actually go to a model with two species, probably I'll work this out next time. One of the questions that you kept asking is, why is omega C not equal to zero? I'll show you that in this two variable, two species active pattern model, you actually get oscillatory instabilities. Very simple model. No chemistry here, completely driven by active stresses. Okay, so I'll stop there for today and maybe later on we can continue. Questions, if there is anything.
So this, in this case, once it becomes unstable, so initially velocity was zero.
Yes.
So it develops a velocity. So at least numerically, what you find is there's some velocity field.
Yeah, the arrows represent the velocity.
And it's a stationary, right?
Yes.
It will go to some stationary velocity.
So the idea being that there is a advective flux and there is a diffusive flux, and those two are balancing each other.
Okay.
That's the stationary point. So the advective flux, because of the sign of the... So remember, one thing to notice from here is that if this coefficient zeta delta mu was positive, or basically the product of zeta delta mu times df by dc was positive, there's no instability possible then. Sorry, if it was negative, the other way around. If it was negative, then there's no instability possible. So the thing that you require is that this coefficient be positive. Physically, it means that the gel that you're trying to look at should generate mechanochemical forces, which will eventually lead to contractility. So they'll try to condense in, collapse inwards. There's diffusion trying to push it outwards. Somewhere there'll be a balance. And that's the point where you get the stationary balance.
Sorry, shouldn't this coefficient be negative for it to be unstable?
The sign should be other way.
Have I screwed up the sign?
Because you had a minus outside, right? Lambda q is minus.
Yeah, possible that I've screwed up the sign. So I put the minus d outside. So I want this whole thing should be negative. You're right. Thank you. Yeah, so, yeah, you should have seen that. So it's 1 minus this, so therefore this should be large enough for this to be negative. Okay, everything crystal clear? So, I mean, depending on what is interesting. So tomorrow I can work out either the oscillatory patterns for this two species model. It's also quite simple. The math is very similar to this. And surprisingly, we found there is something like a Turing pattern, but for active materials. It's not exactly Turing, but the criteria seems to be something like that. And what I want to show, maybe completely in slides tomorrow with a little bit of blackboard, is that this model is not just a toy model for understanding these patterns. We've used this model to explain some real biological patterns with loads of complexities of the chemistry. Seems to capture things quantitatively well. I'll try to discuss that too. Questions? Or hungry? Hungry. Okay.